I'm excited to see this room of people who in Manhattan, people willing to hear more about knowledge graphs and to see all these great use cases. So it's an amazing conference. It's a miracle that Francois and Thomas and the rest of the team managed to put together such a great combination of vendors and researchers and developers and enterprise customers. And yes, we're very happy to support this conference. So in this presentation, I won't talk that much as a vendor, although we are known as a developer of GraphDB and people who do a lot of text analysis and stuff. I would rather build on this experience and tell you a couple of use cases related to market intelligence. And then based on this, I'll share our vision of how knowledge graphs and big knowledge graphs and analytics on big knowledge graphs can help these use cases and essentially pretty much any use case that needs heavy data linking across different data sets or text analysis and enriching knowledge graphs from unstructured sources. So imagine you're an investment banker or you're an advisor or you're a corporate development person. You quite often have to answer questions like, well, imagine that I'm GlaxoSmithKline and I have to figure out what are my investment targets if I want to catch up with AstraZeneca or Pfizer or whoever else in personalized medicine. And then you need to be able to get a unified view on quite a lot of information of who bought whom, what are the relationships, what are the joint ventures, what are the subsidiaries, because these big companies, they're actually ecosystems, and actually on this picture I choose small ones, that in order to figure out who deals with whom and what the relationships are, that's quite a lot of work. And you have to combine data sets from all over the place to build this picture. So that's the first use case that I wanted to share with you. That's precisely one of the biggest M&A practices on Earth. And they bought databases, company data from all places that money can buy. And we essentially built a knowledge graph for them, combining this data and doing the analytics to analyze capital flow and all sorts of things that the person in this position cares about. Another use case, a completely different thing, it is one of the leading business information agencies in Asia, and they want to build a new company research or investment research or just company data service, because many of these services that work quite well for US and for Europe actually don't work so well and don't have the same coverage and quality of the data for Asia. If you want to find an automotive part distributor in Malaysia or manufacturer of elevators in Indonesia or Vietnam, you will have a very hard time, because all the data that you can buy is quite sparse, and the profiles of the companies that you can get for these countries are not as good as those that you get for US. So you end up again buying data from all sorts of places, and in order to make to get good coverage and good quality of the data, you need to also extract a lot of data from unstructured sources to populate and make good profiles. And the third case, these are all real projects. It's with one of the big rating agencies. They have a subsidiary which provides reference prices for gas and oil. And they want to have a common view on several databases that have something to do with their business, proprietary data, as well as news and other content that may have something to do with the price of oil, be it whatever decision made by the government of Iran or a military conflict that happens next to an important oil field or gas pipeline. These are all things that may impact the price of oil, and these people should be able to see them. So again, it was a project of putting together pretty much all the information that may have something to do with the global market of oil and gas in a big knowledge graph. So the wisdom that we got through these projects is that essentially, nowadays, in order to be competitive, businesses, particularly big businesses, international businesses, need to combine global information, external information with their proprietary wisdom and proprietary databases. And doing this right is actually quite a lot of work, and it doesn't come easy because matching entities and deduplicating entities across different sources, do you want to call it record linkage or object consolidation or something else, is a very, very complex problem. And you need a lot of background information to be able to deal with this, right? And you need even more information if you want to match objects that you know about in a database with information that you can extract from text. So I'll get a little bit deeper into like the kinds of data that you can deal with for market intelligence purposes and for investment banking and also for compliance. If you have to deal with company data, we've seen tons of projects where there is no single source which can give you everything that you need. So you have to combine a few of these sources, and even after you combine them, for instance, the classifications of the companies, the business lines, the information about their products, it's again not sufficient. So you can buy the most expensive database and you can still don't have industry classifications for half of the companies there. And even when you have them in a classification like GICS, which is one of the more popular taxonomies of industry sectors, there is no sport. I mean, Adidas and Nike are classified as recreational facilities. Good work if you want to make some decisions on this basis. So it's very, very different view on the market that quite often you get through these databases. And again, even with matching all these data and reclassifying companies, you again need to get more data from text. So we've been dealing with all sorts of different databases that you can use for this purpose, all the way from really big databases like Dun & Bradstreet and Bureau van Dijk and FactSet, which are like quarter billion entities trying to cover everything on Earth. And then other databases like Capital IQ and products of Refinitiv that you heard about yesterday, which address a small number of companies but with high quality and rich information. And then all sorts of open data that you can get about it. So combining this data together doesn't come cheap, but we've been mastering this, and we've been mastering the process of putting these kind of data sets, integrating them and putting them in a big knowledge graph for quite a while. So now we're at the point where you can get like five of these sources and combine them with your proprietary database, and you get the first usable version of your knowledge graph in a matter of a couple of months. And as all these sources are in market intelligence, time is really important. So these sources are being updated all the time. So we also can build an ETL pipeline which rebuilds the entire graph of all these sources and does the entity linking again and again, and all the necessary fixes overnight. But the wisdom that we got is that using standard techniques, like name matching techniques, all sorts of distance measures and rules that you can write, you're getting to levels of accuracy which is like, I don't know, something like 85% of F score. And to go beyond this, you actually need to have need magic. You need much deeper knowledge about the entities, and you should be able to deal with their profiles and in a way their meaning to be able to get better accuracy. And in business you quite often need this. And that's the motivation why we start thinking of how, I don't know, what techniques can be used to exploit what you can get out of big knowledge graphs to model the kind of intelligence that people have and the kind of knowledge that people have, and which allows human experts to match one company here to one company there. And that's what we call context or awareness about entities and concepts, and it comes in different forms. So it's not a single kind of thing that we know. It's knowing what the differentiating features are, knowing what the classes of the entities are, being able to figure out which entity is similar to which other entity, knowing importance and popularity, because when you don't have explicit information, you should assume that, okay, that's probably the more important company because if it was the less important IBM, somebody would make a qualification or anything like this. So you need all this kind of information, including like co-occurrence, what kind of companies typically co-occur in text, to derive rich profiles, which can help you to do everything like data linking and text analysis with better accuracy. And that's what we call awareness. And we've been developing methods and techniques for knowledge graph analytics which help you derive this kind of awareness from a knowledge graph to get it to the level like something like what people mean when I say, well, I'm aware of Cup Center, I know Juan. What does this mean? We are trying to model, obviously, part of this understanding with knowledge graph analytics in order to be able to automate data linking. And this requires critical mass. So for a specific domain, to get to this level of knowledge, you need a lot of, definitely billions of facts. In most of the domains that we have experience with, you have to deal with hundreds of millions of concepts and entities. And you also need quite a lot of documents where these entities are mentioned to be able to pick up sufficient context, a sufficient number of patterns, so that you can do analysis later on, right? And the final goal is to get to the level of awareness that a graduate would have out of college about the domain that he or she was studying. So at this point, I tend to play on what I call awareness game. Let's see whether the projector will allow me to do it. So let's start with something simple. Important airports near New York. Just, yeah. Something else, yeah? New York, something else? Okay, so we have this demo service called FactForge. And one of the queries there is, well, get airports within 50 miles of a specific entity. And the standard query goes with London, but I'll change it with New York now. And it turns out that there are 38 airports within 50 miles from New York. But the three of them that you mentioned, sorry that you don't see it so well, but right at the top of this list, you have JFK, Newark, and LaGuardia. And on the right, you see the importance ranks of these entities. And this is nothing more than, yeah, essentially page rank on top of an RDF graph, which is standard feature in GraphDB. Okay, next question. The most popular banks in US. I see half of them here. If not all of them, but just help me, shout a few names, and then we'll keep playing. On to text, yeah, Wells Fargo. I see JP Morgan Chase. Who else? Yeah. Citi. Okay. So again, we have a service, demo service again, which allows us to demonstrate these kind of things. Like you pick a sector, you pick a company. An industry, and then you just get the most popular entities. But the baseline is that's just a demonstration of the capability of, doing this kind of scores for all sorts of entities for hundreds of thousands of different companies and places and people. You see Goldman Sachs, World Bank. Yeah, World Bank is not an American bank, but it's headquartered in US, and this is the way query was made. So we can easily filter out international companies. But then you see Citi and JP Morgan Chase and Wells Fargo and all the other suspects. So final thing in this game, companies, businesses similar to Google, without thinking, Bing, who else? Amazon, yeah. Google is quite a beast because they do plenty of things. I don't want to offend my friend Danny. You should be able to, and this is part of the experiment of picking up companies which have similar business profiles And here, okay, I've increased again. You see like Facebook, Yahoo, Apple, AOL, Microsoft, Amazon. So that's not perfect, but you see that with very standard techniques, in the top 10, you can get a lot of these companies that you expect to see in such a game. I won't play IBM because it's easy in the interest of time. So this demonstration was going on top of demo service, which is like 2 billion triples, 2.5 billion triples, combination of DBPD geo names, company data, and a lot of news information which allows us to do these popularity things, and a lot of inferred knowledge also. So to properly deal with this kind of knowledge graphs, you need a lot of infrastructure to be able to explore like a repository where you have 1,400 different classes. That's because we loaded FIBO and DBPD and a few other things. And then facilities to figure out what are the typical relationships between the different classes of objects and so on and so forth. Colors don't look great. That's Columbia University. I can give you a private demo. So all sorts of visualization facilities just to be able to figure out what's in there. So we do these kind of things with GraphDB because it has a plugin architecture which allows us to put together different things and extend the basic database engine with other features like geospatial constraints, this kind of stuff like within 50 miles from, and full text search connectors and MongoDB connectors and so on. So we have a few connectors that are that do this kind of analytics. One of them is this PageRank thing that we call RDF rank in the context of an RDF knowledge graph. And then we have a couple of similarity plugins that I have hope to have the time to discuss with you. This RDF rank thing is incredibly important and incredibly simple because we find good use of it in multiple projects and also in the user interface. So these auto-suggestions where I started typing New York, and when I typed new and I got New York City at the second place, this is because they were sorted by PageRank. And we use it for all sorts of other features, including for similarity assessment. Similarity. Why we want to do this and what is it about? Well, essentially, you can do a lot of stuff and you can get a lot of knowledge out of a knowledge graph if you write Sparkle, but writing Sparkle is really tedious. So it can take ages to make the right Sparkle query. So we need a different mechanism which allows us to essentially search and to explore knowledge graphs. And these kind of similarity techniques can also help detect duplicates and help in entity matching. So the first model that we did was trying to assess similarity based on common ages. So if you have two companies, Big Fucking Rocket and Venus Express, which are both located in San Francisco and both are in the aerospace industry, they have two pairs of ages that they share, located in San Francisco and industry aerospace. So we extrapolated a bit and kept experimenting with this model. We put weights on it, so different predicate object pairs have different information value because those that appear more often are less informative and so on and so forth. It turns out that it is quite useful to introduce a penalty, so if two nodes have different level of importance, then they are less similar. So that's one of the techniques that we use. And this is quite easy to deal with and to do and to customize, even with plain Sparkle queries. You have it as saved queries with this demonstrator. And this was precisely what I was using with this demo for Google, and you can do it for any other company. So the more fancy part of it is actually the more fancy implementation of the same idea is a semantic similarity plugin, which we integrate a library called Semantic Vectors, and it essentially allows you to do vectors for all the nodes in the graph and all the relationship types and the typical things. And as always, it's a reduced dimensionality. You can pick whether you want to have 200 dimension vectors or 2,000 dimension vectors and so on and so forth. So you can do a lot of tuning. So the major benefit in doing this is that you can judge similarity of nodes not on exact match of one and the same edges that they have in common, but also on similar edges. So you can judge two companies being similar because one of them is located in Manhattan and the other one has office in New York City. With the more trivial model, this will add no value to the similarity. With embeddings and with text analysis and with, word vec type of embeddings, this is now possible. And you can get this out of the box. Thank you very much.